Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Mr. Chairman, I would like to thank Professor Hani Hafiz and Professor Ayman Arifai for inviting me for our prestigious conference that is growing year by year. And my topic today is about pregnancy-related acute kidney injury, and specifically in preeclampsia and hypertension. First, what are the hemodynamic changes that occur in the normal pregnancy? Normally, there will be widespread vasodilatation all over the body that leads to blood pressure reduction by about 10 millimeter mercury, above the normal in people. Activation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, which is overwhelmed by vasodilator materials, so the blood pressure drops in spite of this. Total body water is increased by 6 to 8 liters. Sodium retention, about 90 to 100 milliequivalent throughout the whole pregnancy. Increase in adrenal natriuretic peptide that aids in total body water retention and sodium retention. Increased sympathetic activity lead to increased heart rate, 15 to 20%, with subsequent increase blood volume, heart rate, increase in cardiac output by about 30% in the early first trimester, peaks about 50% increase in cardiac output by the third trimester. What about the kidney? There is increase in the renal volume by about 30% with subsequent increase in the renal size by length by 1 to 1.5 centimeters, increased renal blood flow and elevation of GFR hyperfiltration by about 40 to 60%, renal pelvis and calcium system dilatation, which is mainly, as you know, more on the right side, and the compression of the left renal vein, nutcracker effect, between the gravid uterus and anteriorly and the aorta posteriorly, which leads to somewhat lower limb edema and may be predisposed to DVT. Acute kidney injury in pregnancy has many causes. Could be classified early in pregnancy before 20 weeks and late in pregnancy after 20 weeks. Commonly, early in pregnancy, pre-renal hyperemesis gravidarum, intrarenal causes such as chronic kidney disease progression, autoimmune diseases such as glomerulonephritis, complications, hemorrhage, sepsis, TTB, antiphospholipid antibodies. While late in pregnancy, pre-renal causes includes bleeding, acute fatty liver of pregnancy, intrarenal causes includes eclampsia, preeclampsia, hemolytic uremic syndrome, and activation of autoimmune glomerulonephritis. Postpartum, of course, postpartum bleeding, retained clots after operative delivery, intrarenal such as HUS, severe preeclampsia, postpartum preeclampsia or ATN from bleeding. We all know the recent definition of American Heart Association, American College of Cardiology for hypertension, that is normal less than 120, and stage 1 hypertension over 130 over 80. In pregnancy, American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists defined hypertension, normal blood pressure in pregnancy, still less than 140 over 90, and mild hypertension, 140 to 155, severe hypertension, more than 160 systolic, and more than 110 diastolic. Categories of hypertension in pregnancy include chronic hypertension, gestational hypertension, preeclampsia and eclampsia, or chronic hypertension with preeclampsia on top. What about these definitions? How could we differentiate these definitions? It is classified hypertension present either in the first 20 weeks or after 20 weeks. Hypertension in the first 20 weeks, it is usually chronic hypertension, either predating pregnancy, and the patient is known by history to have hypertension, or recognized prior to, which is 20 weeks gestation. It's either confirmed by 24-hour ambulatory or home blood pressure monitoring, majority due to essential hypertension, and maybe some forms of white coat hypertension, which is detected only during medical visits. Late after 20 weeks gestation, it is either gestational hypertension that develops during pregnancy at any gestational age and resolves within pregnancy itself, or gestational hypertension more than 20 weeks gestation without the features of preeclampsia. The usual course is to resolve after pregnancy, but maybe carries the risk of chronic hypertension later on, or persistence after pregnancy. And our topic today is the preeclampsia category. The definition of preeclampsia, as done by International Society for the Study of Hypertension in Pregnancy, new onset hypertension defined more than 140/90, accompanied by one or more of the following features: proteinuria more than 300 milligrams per 24 hours, other maternal organ dysfunction, liver, kidney, neurological, hematological involvement, or uteroplacental dysfunction, fetal growth retardation, or detected by Doppler. So proteinuria became unessential for diagnosis of hypertension. Any maternal organ dysfunction or uteroplacental dysfunction with hypertension is considered to fit in the diagnosis of preeclampsia, even in the absence of proteinuria. The earliest description of preeclampsia was by 1669 by Francois Mouret. 1943, albuminuria was first detected in urine, in addition to headache and visual changes and lower limb edema that occurs with pregnancy. 1960s, preeclampsia defect in placental implantation, as I will see later on. And 1998, Roberts et al., impaired placental perfusion and widespread maternal endothelial dysfunction, multisystemic involvement, not only the placenta and not only the hypertension. It is some sort of multisystem involvement that affects all endothelial systems in the body, especially fenestrated endothelium. Over 50,000 maternal deaths worldwide per year, and the reports came from USA, Canada, and from Far East, usually Egypt. As usual, we have our lack of registry also in this point. So we are not registered in this registry. Risk factors include positive risk factors, family history, previous history, nullipara, multiple pregnancies, advanced maternal age or extremes of maternal age, in vitro fertilization, accompanying maternal comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, placental approach, and accidental hemorrhage of placenta, and negative risk factors include maternal smoking and prolonged sexual cohabitation. This study was done about the side effects or the complications of pregnancy in the young ages in the Upper Egypt, and published 2010 in the International Journal of Gynecology. As you can see, that eclampsia is the highest under the age of 15 years. So marriage and pregnancies under the age of 15 years in our Far Egypt carries the highest risk of complication is preeclampsia. What is the pathogenesis of preeclampsia? The process starts of combination of genetic factors with pre-existing risk factors, as I have said, and accompanied with immunological factors that led to the main pathological process, which is shallow placentation or shallow implantation of the placenta. This is a normal spiral artery, which is invaded by trophoblasts after fertilization and implantation to form the placenta, placental sinusoids later on. This is the normal spiral artery with its invasion through the sinusoids in the placenta. As you can see, it is dilated, so gives a slow flow of blood and time for oxygenation. While with shallow implantation, there is lack of this dilatation, rapid flow, rapid jet of blood that destroys surrounding sinusoids and do not give efficient time for oxygenation. So the placenta becomes ischemic. This results in stage one, shallow placentation, reduced placental perfusion, oxidative stress, and coming into stage two, which increase circulating cell factor like tyrosine 1 kinase and endoglein, decrease placental growth factors and vascular endothelial growth factors. These are the two important molecules involved in the pathogenesis of placenta: soluble factor like tyrosine kinase 1 and the imbalance of angiogenic factor, anti-angiogenic factor in favor of angiogenic factor. So decrease angiogenic formation in the placenta. This soluble factor, tyrosine kinase, acts as a cofactor for vascular endothelial system, for vascular endothelial growth factor in its combination to its receptor. So by increased amount, which is increased by placental ischemia, it combines this molecule and preventing its normal binding to its receptor. This results in inhibition of signaling, endothelial cell dysfunction, and finally formation of preeclampsia. This process results in systemic vascular dysfunction, capillary leak, and vasospasms that affects proteinuria, glomerular endotheliosis, coagulation abnormalities, and angiotensin hypersensitivity. This combination results in vascular affection. Many anti-money molecules decrease vasodilator substances, especially nitric oxide, increase endothelin, and increase growth factor, decrease for anti-angiotensin growth factors. This results in vasoconstriction, inactivation of renin angiotensin system with subsequent hypervolemia, both results in hypertension. You saw hypertension due to vasoconstrictive materials and many activation of renin angiotensin system. Vasoconstriction, placental hypoperfusion, imbalance of angiogenic factor, endothelial dysfunction, mainly affects fenestrated endothelium such as placenta, maternal kidneys, liver, and the brain, placental activation, intravascular coagulation, reactive oxygen species, type 1 receptors. Severe preeclampsia affects CNS, thrombocytopenia, renal insufficiency, liver, and lead to pulmonary edema, and usually severe elevation with blood pressure more than 160 over 110. What about the kidneys? The same process occurs. The kidney is full of blood vessels, so the blood vessels are affected by the same factors. Vascular endothelial growth factor imbalance, soluble factor like tyrosine 1. The main process is hypertrophy of endothelial cells, what is known as endotheliosis, which results in podocyte effacement, podocyturia, and increased nephrin and podocyte markers in urine with formation of proteinuria. Moreover, there is prominence of vasoconstrictor materials and decreased GFR and increased serum creatinine and increased endothelin and vasoconstrictive material in favor of vasodilator materials. Renal TMA also can occur due to procoagulant mechanisms and increased tissue factors. So, preeclampsia-induced glomerulopathy, blockage of vascular endothelial growth system, endotheliosis is the main pathological process, which was first identified in the 1950s, TMA, podocytopathies and proteinuria, and may later on chronic kidney disease. This is the picture of endotheliosis, hypertrophy of endothelium, and we can see it come from by inside the glomeruli, some form of TMA. AKI in preeclampsia is approximately 1% of women with severe preeclampsia. It accounts for 15 to 20% of cases of pregnancy-induced acute kidney injury. Usually occurs antepartum, not in postpartum form of preeclampsia, in the settings of other complications, and not, does not occur alone. Placental accidental hemorrhage, DIC, sepsis, or intrauterine fetal death. Higher in the setting of early onset gestation, preeclampsia, and eclampsia. Causes of AKI in pregnancy includes renal hypoperfusion, ATN, amyloid B cortical necrosis, TMA, or severe hypertension. It carries some CKD risk, as published in this study 2010, American Journal of Kidney Disease, 4 times 31% than those with normal pregnancy. Developing end-stage disease with recurrent preeclampsia was noticed. All these studies noticed that chronic kidney disease can follow acute kidney injury of preeclampsia. In spite of that, the usual course after delivery of the baby is improvement. But there is some incidence, as I have said, 30% to reach to chronic kidney disease. As differential diagnosis include TTB, AHUS, systemic lupus flare, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, and acute fatty liver of pregnancy. Differentiating factors between these items includes the value of blood pressure, neurologic involvement, fever, presence of fever, presence of schistocytes, and low platelet count, elevated liver enzymes, and low Adams T13, which is observed in TTB forms and may be observed in preeclamptic form of the disease. So some markers recently proposed for the diagnosis, such as alteration in the angiogenic pathway markers, placental growth factor, soluble factor tyrosine-like kinase 1, endogaline, and the ratio between soluble factor tyrosine kinase 1 to placental growth factor is the most important, carrying a negative prediction of more than 99% and positive prediction 32% for screening. Also, fetal and placental messenger RNA could be are studied as markers for this disease, and proteomics are going to take place in
as an early marker for diagnosis. I think it was 20 minutes. And if the program cut 20 minutes, could you give me more 2 minutes? Circulating level in megaline, placental growth factor, and the most important is soluble factor T1. Treatment, the only established definitive therapy for preeclampsia is delivery. Delivery of the fetus, especially that we are in acute kidney injury. It is one of the major complications. Delivery of the fetus is the main sign of treatment. Conservative management only, pregnancies between 24 to 34 weeks, not having a major organ affection. Antihypertensives for prevention, sufficient lower blood pressure, sufficient fetal placental presentation. Reasonable target blood pressure, systolic about 150 to 100, mean arterial pressure 105 and 125. These drugs could be used for prevention, all in class C except methyl-DOPA, the only is class B. Low dose aspirin recommended for preeclampsia prophylaxis in women at high risk. Regarding fluid management in acute kidney stage till the time of delivery, total fluid intake usually recommended to be less than or equal to 125 milliliters per hour, especially in the states of oliguria. Usually, as usual in the AKI, we use normal saline or lactated Ringer solution. Novel therapeutic strategies includes ligands for soluble factor like tyrosine kinase 1. Sildenafil was tried with some success, but no evidence-based data. Parvastatin in form of the statins was tried also. Apheresis was tried using the transulfate apheresis that is used for LDL, carrying the idea of removal of excess anti-angiogenic proteins. And this study showed that this is the ratio of soluble factor tyrosine-like kinase to placental growth factor. The red is with apheresis, and the blue is without apheresis. And this is the duration of pregnancy. As you can see, with the use of apheresis, we can prolong the duration of pregnancy in all levels of this bad markers for the disease. This case report was published in PMJ case reports about the use of eculizumab with some success in case of preeclampsia proved to be preeclampsia. So in my conclusion, the diagnosis of preeclampsia mainly hypertension more than 20 weeks of gestation, more than 140 over 90, with proteinuria or end organ damage or uterine insufficiency. Pathogenesis mainly, please remember, soluble factor like tyrosine kinase 1, vascular endothelial growth factors, imbalance of angiogenic factors, poor placental implantation, placental ischemia, and endothelial dysfunction. The main cause of AKI is mainly hypoperfusion in addition to TMA and hypertension, severe hypertension. New markers for the diagnosis, as I have mentioned, prevention, proper control of blood pressure in the absence of major organ affection, and treatment, the main item of treatment is delivery. Thank you very much.